Well, I'm going to be sharing various things that God has been speaking to me through his precious saints. And the first one is from Bob Jones. And I'm just going to be touching on a bunch of things. And he talked about the ability for the body of Christ, for us as God's people, to live above the snake line. And living above the snake line is basically living above the influence and the attacks of the enemy, the demonic forces. And if there is a place that we can live, that the enemy doesn't touch us, doesn't have the access. Jesus lived in that place. And he showed us how to do that. And Psalm 84, verse 5, says this in the Amplified version. I love this when I read this. I began to, because he talks about this highway of holiness, and that's what it is. Living above the snake line is walking on the highway of holiness. And so we're going to look at that for a few minutes. And it says in Psalm 84:5, from the Amplified version, it says this: blessed, happy, fortunate is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. That means in our heart there is a highway that takes us to Zion, the place of God, the mountain of the Lord, the city of God, within our very heart. That means within our heart there's this highway of holiness, there's this path, there's this access. Blessed and fortunate is the man whose strength is in you, God, and in whose heart are the highways to Zion. That is powerful. That is absolutely a powerful passage that we could teach on all night, just that. But perhaps that's something you'll take and you'll meditate on. In Isaiah 55, I'm not going to read the whole passage, but it does say, come to me with your ears wide open. Listen, for the life of your soul is at stake. And I am ready to make an everlasting covenant with you. I will give you all the mercies and the unfailing love I promised to David. And then I'll go down to the bottom where it says, go on to verse 8. My thoughts are completely different from yours, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you can imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. And it goes on to say, the rain and the snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry. It is the same with my word. I send it out, and it always produces fruit. It will accomplish all I want it to, and it will prosper everywhere I send it, and you will live in joy and peace. I love to highlight, you follow what I'm saying, where what God is doing, when it's action. You know, I will do, I will do, I will do this, I will do that. And then he says over in Isaiah 35, 8, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. And the main road will go through that once deserted land, and it will be named the Highway of Holiness. Evil-hearted people will never travel on it. It will only be for those who walk in God's ways. Fools will never walk there. Lions will not lurk along its course. And there will be no other dangers. Only the redeemed will follow it. Those who have been ransomed by the Lord will return to Jerusalem, singing songs of everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be overcome with joy and gladness. So the highway of holiness is for those, you know, who walk in God's ways. The redeemed will follow it. And so that is what it means to live. That's just a few minutes about living above the snake line. Bob Jones was also talking about living by the faith of the Son of God. Now that's not our faith. That's the faith of the Son of God. I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. It's living by the faith of the Son of God. Sometimes we try to, oh, I've got to stir up my faith. You know, and it does talk about, you know, stirring up your faith and all of that. But there is the place to do that. But there is the place that we come into this realm where God is bringing it into this realm of his faith being poured out through us. Literally, Jesus' faith. If he's in us, then it's his faith in us. So it's by living by his faith. He is absolutely confident, was absolutely confident in the Father. Never questioned anything, never doubted. And so that's place. It's the place of no doubt. It's the place of absolute confidence, absolute assurance of what his Father is saying and doing. The faith of the Son of God. And that is very different from our faith. He went on to talk about, and when I was listening to something this week by him, it was living above the snake line. He had given a 100-year prophecy, and I'm not going to unfold the 100 years that he did tonight. I'm just taking the decade that we're living in, which is 2010 to 2020. And he said 2010 and 2020 is the time for the true shepherds of love to arise. Shepherds that love, that will lay down their lives for those that are under their care, that God has put in there, if I'm saying accountability, that will love that everything they do, every motivation, every single thing is lived as the one, the shepherd of love that's within them. That's what comes forth. And he says, and what will be entrusted to these shepherds of love is creative miracles. These are the ones who will see as they pray, organs form out of nowhere. You know, legs grow. Healings and miraculous signs and wonders will take place. And what he's looking for is shepherds of love who do not use it as a platform, do you follow what I'm saying? But it's from the pure place of compassion and holy love. And it's from this place of walking and living on the highway of holiness and living by the faith of the Son of God. Because did Jesus ever doubt anybody that he stretched forth his hand to touch? Was there ever a second of doubt? See, that's the faith of the Son of God. You know that you've heard, stretch forth your hand and believe the healing, and you know it will be accomplished. This is where he's bringing us and what he's looking for. And I know what he spoke to me this year, it is a year of jubilee. I was at a meeting the other night, and I actually want to get in touch with this brother who really has a deep understanding of a lot of, you know, Israel and Jewish things. He talked about this is not just a seven-year jubilee. It's a 70th year. Jubilee and this whole revelation on it, but I can't go into it because I need to get more understanding of it. But the Lord did say to me, this is a year that you can look to have your debts forgiven. Ask him. Seek him to be set free from the past. And to truly leave the past behind, whatever that may be, financial, you follow what I'm saying, sort of relational, something that you're carrying, it's the place to let go of everything. And the other thing I heard was it's a year of restoration and reconciliation and to call upon God for that, whether it's relationships, family, friendships, prodigal sons and daughters returning home, the lost finally being saved, that we really are to press in for this and believe for it. Now, what I'm going to begin is I want to share. This book was given to me. Both of these books I'm going to be sharing from were given to me as Christmas presents. So when I began to press into these books, it was never with an intention to teach from them or share from them. And it's not that I was didn't want to take the time. I spent a lot of time with this. But I really felt that the Lord wanted me to bring forth some of what I've been learning from them and share it, because I feel it is a blueprint for this hour and for this time, for this body. That's who I'm speaking to here. I believe it's for the body of Christ. These were written for the body of Christ. But as I read them, taking it for myself, I felt that he said, you need to bring this forth, and there's going to be some activation with this. So this is by Joyce Myers, and it's called Power Words. What you say can change your life. What you say can change your life. So she talked about, and some of this I will read, okay, because so you'll get the context of it. She talks about Isaiah, Jeremiah, Hosea, Ezekiel, Jonah, and other prophets. To fulfill their God-ordained missions, they had to be completely submitted to the Lord. Not only did their hearts and minds need to be in submission to God, but their mouths also had to be His. And so, really, what God uses is submitted people to bring forth His messages in our mouths, and what comes out of our mouth is absolutely critical if we want to be used by God. And what the state and the condition of our mouth actually determines how and where and when God will use us. It really is a determining factor, as we are going to see. God's word says in Proverbs 25:11 that we can speak a word in due season to the weary. So some of us have been called to preach, some to small audiences, some to big audiences, some of us have been taught to teach. I mean, we all have different things, but every one of us has been called to speak words of life and words of encouragement in due season to people. Every single one of us is to be the voice of the Lord in the sphere of influence that He has given to us, our homes, our friends, our families, our workplace, and wherever else He may put you, whatever that may look like. The size of the audience isn't important. What's important is to be faithful with what God gives us to do and be obedient to His leading. And He spoke powerfully through the prophet Isaiah, but before He did and could, He had to deal with Isaiah's mouth. We're going to look at Isaiah's mouth, and we're going to look at Jeremiah's mouth. And Isaiah's mouth was an unclean mouth. That's what the Word of God says. His mouth was unclean. God called him, but He said to him, your mouth is unclean. I can't use you till I clean up your mouth. And so, remember, it says here, when God called Isaiah, He gave him a dramatic vision. Isaiah actually saw the Lord sitting on His throne, and he heard the angels crying. So he saw and he heard. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory. That's what the angels were crying. Now, what was Isaiah's response to what he saw and what he heard? It was his response, Cherish, and his response was this: woe is me, for I am undone and ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Now it's interesting that when Isaiah was in the presence of the Lord, suddenly he sees he's a man of unclean lips. Before that, he was just like, whatever. God can use me. God's called me. He says, I'm going to give you a vision. Now let's see what you think of yourself. Not to make him feel bad, for him to understand his state. Because this place of a highway of holiness, this place of this is the King of glory, high and lifted up, where they say, holy, holy, holy. And we want to be a vessel and a mouthpiece for a holy God. That means He wants to deal with any place in our lives that our lips are unclean. Okay? But he didn't see it until he had the vision. So, that okay? We good up to now? And so we know the story. Then flew one of the seraphim to me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, and with it he touched my mouth and said, behold, this has touched your lips, your iniquity and guilt are taken away, and your sin is completely atoned for and forgiven. So, after the angel touched Isaiah's mouth, and not before, then God himself spoke to Isaiah with a question. God himself now speaks to him and says to Isaiah, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Well, who's the us? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Correct? So, here am I, send me, he says. Then God gave Isaiah some instructions. Go and tell this people. And then he gives him what to say. But that was a whole process. And oftentimes we can be in a place of, well, why is that one being given that platform when they're speaking here, there, in the Godless anointing, blah, 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 blah. It's a good possibility because they've let themselves be brought through the process. Because if we think we're going to speak for a holy God and then go over here and talk about our neighbor, or speak for a holy God and then go over here and release a curse, or speak for a holy God and live in a place of negativity, we're deceived. Because what's good for Isaiah is good for us. You follow what I'm saying? And so, so often God needs to cleanse people before he uses them. As I said, there was this whole procession. We see from Isaiah that when we come into God's presence, he deals with us. Well, we know that. However, it says this. She says this, and I love this. Isaiah had a perfect heart towards God, even though he had some imperfection in his actions. God always looks for people whose hearts are perfect towards him, not for people whose performances seem perfect or who seem to do everything right. When God knows he has a person's heart that is loyal to him, he also knows he can work with that person to make the necessary changes in their thoughts, in their words, and in their behavior. Remember David? I mean, David blew it, right? Big time. But what did God still say to him? He's a man after my heart. He never changed it. He never changed his mind about David. He didn't use him to do some of the things that he was promised to do. The next generation had to do it, Solomon, because he had blood on his hands. And so, the blood of myrrh. Not blood from war that God had called him to, the blood of myrrh. Even though he did murder him, he gave the orders for myrrh to cover up his sin. But his heart was perfect, and because his heart was after God's, God could send the prophet to him and say, you're the man, David, you follow what I'm saying? And he fell in sackcloth and ashes and repented and the whole thing. God knew that he could deal with him. And so if our hearts are pliable and workable with God, he'll use us. He's after our hearts, we're after his, that's what it's all about. 2 Timothy 2:21, before we move on to Jeremiah. It says, whoever cleanses himself from what is ignoble and unclean, who separates himself from contact with contaminating and corrupting influences, will then himself be a vessel set apart and useful for honorable and noble purposes, consecrated and profitable to the master, fit and ready for any good work. That's us doing it. Do you follow what I'm saying? We bring ourselves before him. We cleanse ourselves. We ask the Lord, search us. We acknowledge where we have blown it. We consecrate ourselves. We set ourselves apart. We remove ourselves from anything that's going to contaminate us. Anything that would cause us to step off the highway of holiness, we must separate ourselves from if we want to walk in the realms of God I'm talking about. And so, let's look at Jeremiah for a few minutes. She goes on to say, I agree with this, we need God to teach us to speak differently than we have spoken in the past, so our words line up with his words, his thoughts, and his character. You know, if we were to have a tape recorder that we put on ourselves, and it listened, and every time we spoke, it recorded it, then at the end of the day, we listen to it. What would it sound like? I don't know. Only you know. Only you and God know. What would it sound like? Would it sound like God's mouth going through us? Would it sound like the Lord? Would that be his conversations? Would that be his statements? Would that be his decrees? Would it be what he responds, reacts? What would our conversation sound like? Like Isaiah, Jeremiah spoke really powerful, but just like Isaiah, Jeremiah also had to have his mouth dealt with. Now, what was Jeremiah's mouth? Jeremiah had a fearful mouth. Jeremiah had a mouth of doubt. There's another one. A fearful mouth and a mouth that is doubtful. Doesn't trust. Fearful. I'll read Jeremiah 1:4-10. Then the word of the Lord came to me, Jeremiah, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew and approved of you as my own chosen instrument. And before you were born, I separated and set you apart, consecrating you, and I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Then said I, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me, say not, I am only a youth, for you shall go to all whom I shall send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Be not afraid of them or their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put his hand and put forth his hand and touched my mouth. This time it was the Lord, not an angel with a coal. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words to your mouth. See, I have this day appointed you to the oversight of the nations and of the kingdoms to root out, to pull down, to destroy, to overthrow, to build, and to plant. Wow. This is what the Lord is saying to him. In the presence of God, he's going to argue with them. I'm too young. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm not gifted enough. I'm not this. I'm not that. I don't have the money. We have all of these places. That's called a fearful mouth. Fearful statements cancel out the declaration of faith we made a day ago. You just nullify it. We've all done it, have we not? So right after he calls him a prophet to the nations, Jeremiah begins to say God had things that God had not told him to say. She says God's words affirmed his call to Jeremiah and his belief in him. But as soon as he finished speaking, Jeremiah began to confess his doubt and weakness because of his age. God had to straighten out Jeremiah's fearful mouth so he could use him. And so he brings Jeremiah through this process. So we have to understand also that when God calls us to do something, that means everything we have to do it is at our disposal. We may have to call it forth in faith. Do you follow what I'm saying? Sometimes it's suddenly, sometimes it's a process. But we should not say we can't do it. If God has said it, then we can do it. Period. No ifs, no ands, no buts. It's what do we align ourselves with? What do we align ourselves with? So often we can speak out of our insecurities. Is that not true? We can speak out of our insecurities. Oh my gosh, don't have them call on me. Anybody but me. Head down, pretend you're busy. Right? Anybody but me, don't call on me. True? I've done it. So, or we verbalize what others have said about us. It's also not good, you know what I'm saying? Or we give words to what the enemy has put into our minds. So we hear some whisper, and we speak it forth. And now we've just spoken forth an enemy's decree through our mouths. And what does it say? In our mouths is the power of life and death. We have just empowered what the enemy's lie is. Because he can't speak anything except lies and deception. So every time you say something about yourself, or whatever it may be, that is not God's speech, we have empowered alive again. We have enabled it, we have powered it, not only that, we have spoken life to it. And unless we counter it and render it null and void, that hovers there, that stays there, and we wonder why things happen. Oftentimes it's not anybody else speaking anything, it's we ourselves who are cursing ourselves. Because we are lining up with the lies of the enemy. I'm too old, I'm too stupid, I'm too fat, I'm too dumb, blah, blah, blah. I don't have memory, I can't do this. Like, every time we say these things, because we always have to think, we have the mind of Christ. So when we say, you follow what I'm saying? We have to think what we're saying. We have to really hear what we're saying. I'm talking to myself here. Jesus said, I speak not my own words, but the words of the one who sent me. I only say what I have heard my Father say. How about we went on, added to our negativity fast that we have agreed to go on for 40 days? How about we add that we will only say the Father says? We want to be like Jesus. Well, that's how he lived and that's how he spoke. I don't think he blabbered away 100 miles an hour. I don't. I think he was very specific in what he said all the time. I don't think he just blah 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 da da. God is, she says this, God is calling us up higher and he's challenging us to no longer speak our own words. How about that? Well, that's what I just said. He's challenging us to no longer speak our own words. He wants us to speak his words because he wants to use us for his purposes. So how about somebody comes and tells us something, and before we just go up, we wait. What's your thoughts on this, Lord? What do you want to speak into this? Now, I'm not talking about, hey, you want a slice of pizza. You follow what I'm saying? I'm talking. You know? You follow? Yes, I want a slice of pizza. You know? It's, you know what I mean. I'm talking when we're having, you know what I'm saying here. So that means God needs to deal with us. We need to allow him to do everything he needs to do in us for the purpose of then he can do everything he wants to do through us. So he needs to do everything he wants in us so he can do everything he wants to do through us because he has a purpose and he has plans. So for some people, they're new believers. They're just getting going. But others have been walking with him for years. And so it's time for some fine-tuning. And I think that what he's doing in my life, perhaps I think all of our lives here, is, as she said, he is making some precise adjustments in order to release us to our next level. And so what this is precise adjustments I'm talking about here so we can go to our next level. This isn't saying we're failures, do you follow what I'm saying? He's fine-tuning. He's saying even higher, even deeper. He's calling us all to a new place. And every step, every time we step up a new level of blessing and being used by God, we will face new opposition. And that's absolutely true. It's like all of a sudden you have this great thing, a great moment with God or whatever it may be. You know what I'm saying? Like you reach the new place in worship or you whatever. I don't care what it is, but you have this new place. But there will be right there, knocking at your door, guaranteed opposition. It'll come some way. Because it's always sent to try and knock you back. Knock you back. You know, two steps forward, three steps back, that whole thing. No. You follow what I'm saying? It's always to try and stop you, hinder you. Jeremiah had spoken way before God had called him, but once he received God's new assignments for him, his speech had to change. The way he once spoke would have gotten him into trouble as he began to carry out God's plan for his life. Wrong words can open doors we do not want to open for the enemy. And and I had already addressed this, but you know, we don't want to give the devil even a tiny crack, let alone an open door. One way to eliminate those opportunities is to be careful with our words. So wrong words is literally wrong words, open door. And unless you shut that door is open. Unless we repent of those words, take authority over them, understand what they've done, and shut that door remains open. When you have arguments and you don't close that with forgiveness, on prayer or whatever, do you realize that's an open door into whatever that relationship is? Wide open door. And it's not just, it's a stream of that command. Don't think just one little demon saunters in. It's a dance. They'll come dancing into your home, dancing into your heart, dancing into that relationship, and they'll dance right upon that thing until it's a dance of destruction. That's what they're coming in with. Doesn't mean it's not going to happen. It's what do we do with it? And do we bring it to the Lord and do we repent? You follow what I'm saying? It's shut that door. I know with that door, I can feel grief in my heart until that is done. There's an unsettling. There's an unrest till it's made right. And if it's not, then there's something the matter with our conscience. There's something the matter with our spirit. You can go through something and you don't feel anything, something's wrong. Something's very wrong. So instead of opening doors for the enemy, God wants us to speak powerful words of faith that will damage the kingdom of darkness. And we know this. And so, you know, I'd like to get to a place that I don't open any doors. Do you follow what I'm saying? That my mouth is never used to open a door for the enemy. That is my goal. I'm telling you, this year. My mouth, Lord, help me, that I would walk in a highway of holiness. My mouth is not used for anything. And it's time to put away childish ways. Talking like a child, reasoning like a child, thinking like a child, our emotions like a child. Not childlike, I'm talking childish, and that's very different. It's time to lay aside, okay, childish ways. And what does that mean? That means we can no longer say whatever we feel like saying. I'm just going to say it. Just going to blah, 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 blah. That's childish. It's childish. We realize the power of our words and become accountable for them. So the two things that we don't want to do, we don't want to speak is we don't want our mouths to be unclean. And we don't want to have fearful, doubtful mouths. So, we're going to do a little activation right now. I'd like you to take a minute and just ponder with the Lord. Any place where you feel that you've had a fearful moment this week. Just take a minute. Not five. Okay? So, I'd like to have two or three share.
Come up or stay down.
Whatever you want to do.
As most of you know, we had an assignment for tomorrow. And almost everything you said tonight, God's been dealing with me this week. That exact everything. Including seeing Joyce Myers on TV for like 5 minutes and speaking. You know, I mean, it's like, Joyce Myers. The whole fearful, I mean, I've done that for years. Just about speaking just like this. And this is probably one of the first times I've been semi-comfortable. And I think it's because of what's gone on this week. With getting up and speaking. It can paralyze you. That's what Satan puts you into, a coma, a spiritual coma, where you don't even realize that. Years can go by, and all of a sudden you wake up, it's like years have gone by. So, you know, I'll share more tomorrow with, you know, my daily vision and my vision for the year, etc. But I just want...
So this is going to take another minute of your time. I want you to think what God is saying about you. What does God say about you? If you were to listen into heaven, what is God saying about you? Take a minute and listen. And I'm going to go into now, again, this was given to me. It's called Finding Hope by James Gall. Does anybody else have this book? Powerful. So you've already read this. You probably know all this, but you're going to hear it again. So, and I'm going to do actually quite a bit of reading from this. And this is how I'm going to end the night with James Gall. Because this is all building up to this. And, you know, James Gall is an amazing prophet of the Lord, spiritual father, amazing teacher, walks in, just, oh my gosh, I have such a high regard for James Gall. And we know that this book came out of his journey of losing his wife to cancer, himself fighting cancer 3 times, and I love it because he's so raw and he's so real. He's an internationally known man, and yet the rawness and the transparency is what blew me away. I just love this man even more after reading this book. And so he was in this place of, you know, having lost his wife, now he's fighting cancer for the 3rd time. Some people don't make it past the 1st loss, never mind everything else he went through. And he's just had serious back surgery again. So, this is called Born to Sing. So he's in this place, he says, he was talking about losing your bearings. Finding your bearings has to become part of the journey or you'll go in circles. You have to ask yourself some really basic questions, such as, who am I? What do my roots tell me about myself? What do I love to do? What brings me life? Who am I? And reassemble your identity after a major trauma and loss. And so he was in this place of major trauma and loss. This is a man who would speak to the nations and see prophetic words come forth, and yet he was in a place of loss. And he had lost his bearings, and he didn't know which way he was going. And so, all of a sudden, he found himself in this place. He said he realized he wasn't singing anymore. So he says, when I asked myself, what do I love to do? One of my first answers was, I love to sing. At the age of 3 and in high school, I won awards for singing. Just like other guys might win awards for basketball or some other sport, I didn't sing in order to win prizes. I sang because it was my life. I would go on walks down the railroad tracks and I would sing Sunday school songs and hymns from the brownish red Cokesbury hymnal. I would sing anything I heard. I would sing with the radio. I would sing with Lawrence Welk. I would sing everywhere I went, and I grew up being known as a singer. I kept on singing after I grew up, and when I get married, somebody gave me a t-shirt that says, I sing real loud. I would sing when I was happy, I would sing when I was sad, I would sing in the shower, I would sing in the car, I would sing during corporate worship, I would sing in the middle of my own sermons. It didn't matter if I was having a bad voice or a good voice day, I would sing anyways. But in the midst of my pain, I had not been singing much. Once I put my finger on the fact that I was born to sing, I figured out that one of the best keys for unlocking my poor, beat up heart would be telling my heart to sing again. And I would sing life back to it. The importance of our words and the importance of our songs. The songs of our heart. Are we singing a drudge song? I've sung those songs. I think he said, even if you don't use outright singing to do it, you can speak to your heart to revive it. Tell your heart the truth. Tell your heart who is on the throne. Tell your heart about God's faithfulness and goodness and how much the shepherd cares. And then ask yourself, what brings me life? What brings you life? Well, me and Gary saw Daniel today, one of the things that brought him life. He was hugging a tree that was filled with snow, sticking his face in it like a little kid. I loved it. It was awesome. Sorry, Daniel, I couldn't resist.
Mighty white tree hugger.
He even has a picture. Yeah, the mighty white. What did you say?
Mighty white tree hugger.
That's it. He even has the picture to prove it. I'll show it to you later. Powerful picture. I loved it. But it was a grown man like a little boy in wonder of God, getting as close to his creation as he could, putting his face in this snow-filled tree. And I'm saying, who else would do that except some little kid? Not a dignified adult. And what did David say? I will be even more undignified than this. Did he not? In the celebration of God and his creation. Okay? And so, what brings me life? What brings you life? Do you know that if we don't do what brings us life, we begin to die? Our life begins to shrivel up if we don't do what brings us life. Look back across the years, find precious memories and helpful clues about what works for you. Read the Bible as if it was written to you personally. To experience the hidden power of praise and singing, start with Psalms 148, 149, 150, and tell your heart to start to sing again. Tell your heart, speak to it, sing to it. I think we all know when our heart's not singing, don't we? I do. I started singing again. Now I sing my pain away every day. I sing day and night. I sing in every hotel room I go into. I sing in my kitchen. I sing outside when I take a walk. I sing by myself and I sing with others. And recently, I sang crooner songs in a marble lobby of a 5-star hotel in Taipei, Taiwan, with a classic pianist. People started coming up to take videos thinking I was an internationally famous singer. But most of the time, I sing the old hymns I love, such as, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweeter frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand," and on he goes. Come in, can you see him? There he is in this 5-star hotel lobby singing crooning songs that people think he's some famous singer. Why? Because he's doing what he loves to do. I'm sure we've all seen that guy. It's in Rockport and Gloucester on his bicycle. Have you not seen him? Basket Mark on his bicycle, singing at the top of his lungs with his hat and his array. And there he is. You know him. You've seen him, right? You can hear him a quarter of a mile away. He sings at the top of his lungs, and it's every type of song you can think of. It's unbelievable. And he is having a blast. And every time I see him, I get great joy. I don't know who this guy is, but he is having a blast, and he doesn't give a rip about anybody, what they think. I can see it. I can see this guy. If you watch KPN TV, I think you're awesome. So hidden within the lyrics and melodies, the power of praise and worship builds We begin to feel disoriented when we begin to sing and praise and sing the Psalms. It reorients us. It's like the compass is going. You ever see that? Like in a cartoon. And all of a sudden, the songs and the praise, it goes, due north, Zion. You follow what I'm saying? Highway of holiness. There's the path again. That's the power of praise, the power of song, the power of telling our hearts to sing again. Sometimes it takes a moment to overcome the feeling of being shut down, too sad, too tired to breathe out a note of a song. But once I make the effort, I'm so glad I'm alive and held in God's capable hands. It's true. It's true. I mean, it was, I don't know, sometime last week I wasn't feeling good. I was really struggling. I was in a lot of pain. I was like, oh my God, Father, help me. I've got to get up. I've got so much to do. And I get up and I was just really struggling. I got in the shower and I just started to sing. And I'm just going to sing. I'm just going to praise God. And I just started to sing. And the pain didn't go, but my heart began to soar. You follow what I'm saying? And it's like, okay. And instead of, you follow what I'm saying? Before you know it, I was about my day, and it set the tone. You follow what I'm saying? Even in the midst of whatever, it set the tone. He said, I have a special song to sing with my life, and so do you. Not only do we need to tell our hearts to sing again, but we need to hear and learn each other's songs. This can best be explained with the story. So, after I read this, you're going to be stretched a little bit more. Okay? I love the story, and I'm going to read every word of it. It's going to take me a few minutes. I read this story, and I was so undone with it. The power of community. The power of song. The power of knowing who we are, why we were created, and that others know why we were created. Why do we write vision statements and speak them to each other? So I can come and say, what the heck are you doing? That's not your vision. I love you too much to let you go that way. That doesn't line up with what you're doing. But I'm saying, love guides and protects and helps each other run. We were created for. What do you mean you're going to go take that job? Are you kidding me? You're going to die and shrivel up. You were born to do this. You may not make that, but you were born to do this. There you'll have tons of money, but there you'll be alive. What do you mean you're not going to write that book? What do you mean you're not going to do that? You better make the time for it, because that's one of the reasons you're. We all need to speak these things to each other. But if we don't know each other's hearts, if we don't know each other intimately, you can't do that with each other. So now listen to this story. In the northern parts of Africa, there's a semi-nomadic tribe that counts the birthday of a child, not from the day of birth, nor even from the day of conception, but from the day the mother first decides to have a child. Sound like Psalm 139 to you? When a woman decides to have a child, she goes off and sits under a tree by herself and listens until she can hear the song of the child. She's heard the song of this child. She comes back to the man who will be the child's father and teaches him the song. Then when they make love to physically conceive the child, they sing the song of the child as though in the way to invite the child. When she becomes pregnant, the mother teaches that child song to the midwives and the old women of the village. So when the child is born, the old women and the people around her sing the child's song to welcome him or her. No orphan spirit there. As the child grows up, the other villagers are taught the child's song. If the child falls or gets hurt, someone picks the child up and sings that child's song to him or her. If the child does something wonderful or goes through the rites of puberty, then the people of the village sing his or her song to show honor. In the tribe, there is one other occasion when the child's song will be sung. That is when the person does something hurtful or wrong. They take the person to the center of town, and the entire tribe comes and surrounds them. They sing the person's birth song, and then for 2 days they tell the man or woman every good thing he or she has ever done. The tribe believes that every human being comes into the world as good, desiring safety, love, peace, and happiness. But sometimes in the pursuit of these things, people make mistakes. The community sees misdeeds as a cry for help. They band together for the sake of their fellow tribesperson to reconnect the person who he or she really is until they fully remember the truth that they had temporarily forgotten. That they are good, that they have a purpose. They view correction for antisocial behavior not as a punishment, but as love and the remembrance of identity. For when you recognize your own song, you have no desire or a need to do anything that would hurt another. That sounds to me like a restoration of hope. So a person's song is the theme of his or her life. In marriage, it's the husband and wife's song that are sung together. And finally, when the person is lying in his bed ready to die, all the villagers who know the song, come and sing for the last time that person's song. Before we were in our mother's womb, he knew us. We were in thought. He spoke us into existence. We came forth under his song. You may not have been sung over when you came forth. I don't know the circumstances. Many weren't. Many weren't celebrated or even wanted in this world. But God still sang over it. I thought about that. I thought about you walking down the street, you go into a coffee shop, the person you're sitting next to where you work, where we sit and listen and wait for heaven's song. Thought about this. I mean, this is really working in me. Power of the song of God over our lives. Not just his thought, not just what he says about us, but his song over us. He has new names for us. I could go on and on and on about these times with God, but you may not have grown up in an African tribe that sings your song to you at crucial life transitions, but your life is always reminding you when you are in tune with yourself and when you are not. You feel good when your actions match your song, and you feel awful when they don't. When you lose your bearings, you lose your song for a time, and when you get back in touch with who you are, you rediscover your song. It will not be enough to sing your song to yourself. Sometimes you need to sing your song for me and teach it to me. Because we are called to live our lives in community, and we need to learn each other's song. happens, I made up songs for each one of our four kids, and I used to sing them every night when I was home and at bedtime. I remember my oldest son's the best. Here's the ending of it. I like to dream about butterflies. I like to dream about the stars in the sky. I like to dream about you-hoo. I like to dream about you-hoo, and I like to dream about bumpity-bump. Then I would tickle him, and we would laugh. Do you think that son ever forgot this song? It's pretty amazing. I believe that God has a song for us to sing over each other, over whole families, over cities, over nations. Sometimes when I go to a city to minister, I ask God, what song are you singing over this city? And I ask him to tune the ear of my heart to heaven so I can maybe hear a little bit of what heaven is singing there. What is God singing over KB? We talk about the new song. What is God singing? What is God singing over your life, over my life, over this city, over KBM, over your workplace, over your family? God himself is the singing God, you know. The Lord and God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. We all know that, Zephaniah 3:17. What is God singing over you today? I can tell you he is singing an anthem of hope. He is singing, I love you, and I have a plan for your life. I have a great future for you. I have you on my mind, I have you in my heart, and I am working everything together for you. We know for sure that that's what he's singing, because that's in his word. One more story, and then we're going to move into something. He says, here's my hero of hope, Danny Gokey. The next hero of hope is a singer, too. He used to be a church music director in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Now he is a professional singer in Nashville. You may have heard his name because of his music or because of his book, Hope in Front of Me, Find Purpose in Your Darkest Moments. A few years ago, he competed on American Idol when the show was still in its prime, and he came in third place. His American Idol performance took place very soon after his young wife, Sophia, had died during heart surgery. So the fact that he stayed in the running as long as he did was amazing to him. He was still in grief, and as he puts it, 10 months before, I stood at my wife's casket, and I wanted to die along with her. Yet he refused to let his life be defined by his hope-defeating circumstances. He chose to believe that God had a bigger plan for his life. He wrote some more songs. He went on tour. He started a charitable foundation in the Nashville area that he called Sophia's Heart, which helped to meet the needs of children and families. What could have been a dead end became a detour and a new beginning. He told his heart to sing again. Hope is big for Danny, and he is helping make it big, helping to make it big with me. He did not get bitter. Even when he was emotionally, spiritually, and physically spent, he kept on trusting God. He kept following the thread of hope that connected him with the eternal life source. It was his lifeline. Hope reminded him that life exists beyond what we can see, taste, smell, hear, or touch. Hope was always just in front of him and still is. He released a new album to go along with his book, Hope in Front of Me. I'm going to get that one. 3 years ago, he married a beautiful young lady named Layaset. And now they have two small children. We all need heroes of hope in our walks of life. I read this and read it and read it and I've read it and I've read it again and again and again. teach me your song. What is your song? Singing. Learn each other's songs so we can all sing it. What is God singing over you? Sing it. What is God singing over K-Ban? So we can all sing it. And what is he singing this very day? Sing it. It goes back to Isaiah 35. Those who have been ransomed by the Lord will return to Jerusalem, singing songs of everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be overcome with joy and gladness. They will be overcome with joy and gladness. That's not a trickle. That's not a drip. That's overcome with joy and with gladness. And all sorrow and mourning must flee away. Sorrow and mourning cannot stay around us when joy and gladness overtake us and overcome us. So, does anybody have an idea what this song is? I've heard him sing, I've heard him take popular songs and he's sung them over me. I've heard him sing over me tonight. You are so beautiful to me. Can't you see? You're everything I've hoped for. You're everything I've dreamed. You are so beautiful to me. Man, when God sings that over you, you walk a different walk. You don't care what anybody else thinks. I could not hear God. I could not hear the music. I could not hear the drums when I can't hear the drums in the spirit. That's scary to me. I couldn't hear the sound. I couldn't hear anything. And I was just sort of, I was doing everything I needed to do, but I felt dead inside. And all of a sudden I get a call from two people from another state. Can we come and visit you today? Yes. And they drove up from another state. They got five babysitters. They didn't have a lot of money to do that. I know this was costly for them. They came into my kitchen with a big Native American drum, put it on the floor. And she put on Native American moccasins and jingle bell things around her ankles. And she had a dance shawl or something. And He had his drum beaters, and in my kitchen, they beat those drums, they sang in tongues, they danced around me, they sang new songs, old songs, they just moved in the spirit. And did it for I can't know how long. And then at the end, he let out one bang and took the beater and put it right to my spirit, man. And when he did that, everything broke in a moment. The sound was restored, the song was restored, everything opened up again. Because somebody heard from God.
It was obedient.
She's lost the song. She's lost the sound, and she's lost her way. Go and restore. That's the power of that. Probably why that touched me so much, because I've experienced it. Many people had prayed. Many people had laid hands on me. Nobody had sung my song. Nobody had beat the beat. Nobody had been used in a way to press in like that to hear, to then open it up again. Singing songs of everlasting joy, overcome with joy and gladness. Father, help us to hear your song over us. Help us to hear your song over each other. Help us to know each other's song and sounds. Help us to live in community like this. Help us, Father, for even people that we may come in contact to be sensitive. Perhaps there's a song we're to sing over them. A song that will open their hearts. How could you have known that song? Maybe it's a song their mother sang, and their mother's gone home, and they wonder, is there a God? Who knows? You're pretty amazing, Father, what you can do. And Father, Holy Spirit, precious Jesus, help us to have the language of heaven. Help us not to have unclean mouths. Cause us to not speak fearful words. Cause our words to be as Jesus. He only said what he heard you say. He only did what he saw you do. Reduce us to that simplicity, Jesus. And teach us what it is to walk on the highway of holiness above the snake line in communion with you. And I pray this with the glory of your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.